We will now have the last session of today's summit program, titled Benchmarks. Let us invite Mr. Vincent Lo, Chairman of Shui On Holdings Limited, and Mr. Wang Shi, Chairman of Vanke Company Limited, to proceed to the stage, please. Shall we give them a round of applause?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the final session for the day, and certainly last but not least, because we have a very, very unusual and distinguished speaker, Wang Shi, somebody I really have a great deal of respect and admiration for. I think later on when you hear him speak and you learn a bit more about his thinking and his behavior, I think you will have the same feeling. So let me now share with you a very brief introduction of his background. Wang Shi joined the military force in 1968, and then in 73, he worked in the water and electrical supply department of the Zhangzhou Railway. And then he graduated from the Langzhou Railway College in 1978, majoring in water supply studies. And after graduation, he worked for the Guangzhou Railway Bureau, Foreign Trade and Economic Cooperation Committee of Guangdong Province, and Shenzhen Special Region Development Company. But in 1984, he established Shenzhen Exhibition Center for Modern Science and Education Equipment, which is the predecessor of China Vanke. He was the general manager and became chairman and general manager in 1988 when they purchased the first piece of land to develop. And in 1999, Wang Shi became chairman and relinquished his position as general manager. But what is amazing is that Wang Shi, he spent his time climbing mountains. At the age of 53, it was the first time he climbed Mount Everest. He's climbed all the high mountains in the world, and at 59, he climbed Mount Everest the second time. It's truly amazing. And what is also spectacular is that they've only been in properties for 24 years, and Vanke is the largest property company in China. Last year, they had sales of 120 billion renminbi. And how did he achieve that? I think that is something that we should all try and find the answer to. So, Wang Shi, can you just make your presentation and then we'll have a discussion.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My lecture topic, Benchmarks. I believe the simpler a company could introduce itself, the more mature and excellent the company is. For example, it only takes Coca-Cola 3 seconds to describe itself by the biggest soft drink company in the world. Today, 10 minutes is more than enough to introduce Vanke, the biggest home builder, not home builder, that urban residential property developer, a blue chip, and one of the most admired companies in China. Actually, if I speak in Chinese, maybe 6 seconds. 6 seconds. Mm. 20 years ago, it would indeed take me half an hour to introduce myself. I was once a corn dealer. As my business grew, Vanke started to sell bottled water, clothes, watches, tape recorders, and even movies. Someone joked that my business has covered everything except prostitution, gambling, drugs, and arms, and some special industries that permit to companies controlled by government, such as banking, resources, electricity, and telecommunications. In 1993, Vanke was about to issue new shares and told our primary and the right standard and chart that we had a wide business portfolio that included basically everything. But the response surprised me. They could only invest in the top three companies from each sector, and Vanke was not their best choice in any of our business lines. Now, Vanke narrowed down its portfolio into residential homes only, and we became the biggest residential property developer. In our transition to a specialized company, we sold out Sistborn, which to date is still the one of the best non-China brand of bottled water. We sold out Wang Jia, which later became one of China's biggest chain silver store. This choice is not easy. Specialty or diversity. Once I had a debate with Mr. Guo Guangchang, chairman of Fuxin Group. Fuxin Group had four major lines of business: real estate, steel, pharmacy, and mining. He asked me, "Do you know how big the profit is in my steel business?" I respond, "Why should you invest in real estate when steel's profit margin is so high? You will so slowly and surely be gone from my list of rivals." In mainland China, there are many new companies. Maybe they began from the specialist, but when the business is big, so they change to another business majesty, that the diversity. So I think that's not correct or not correct, that different business majority. What's the meaning that the 战略 is majority? 战略. Majesty, right? Not majority. Majesty, I'm sorry. That's the different majesty. Specialization means capacity building. So we looked for benchmarked number one, Sony. Years ago, when Vanke was engaged in the electronics trade, we began to have deals with Sony. Sony impressed me deeply with strong customer service behind the first-class hardware. It truly cares about customers' interest, as opposite to only focusing on short-term stuff. In 1990, Vanke delivered its first property, Tianjin Garden, when we began to build our own customer service. Although, on that time, we had not quite grasped what property service mean exactly. the Sony model took root in Vanke's business philosophy. Vanke's property service, as the result of our learning from Sony, has become one of the top brands in China's service sector. That ought to say that one top of brand in China's service sector. Over 80% of our clients identified property service as the key driver behind their buying decision in favor of Vanke. Benchmark number two, Sinhung Key Properties. The biggest property developer in Hong Kong, Vanke has benchmarked against the SHKP since it entered the home property development sector. Of course, by then, we knew what property service means. We went further to learn SHKP's models of development, marketing, and sales. Then other developers learned those models from us and disseminate further to the rest of China. So today's China's property development model, as you can see, is in fact a Hong Kong model that Vanke borrowed from SHKP. Modeling after SHKP Club, Vanke created China's first property customer club, Vanke Property Customer Club. Currently, VPCC chapters can be found in each of our properties in 53 cities, with a total of 800,000 members, 2.6 times the size of SHKP Club. Following SHKP, we built the first demo unit in China's housing industry. Today, it becomes a common practice. We are still over Mr. KHKP toy. Benchmark number three. Ryan Group, led by Vincent Lo and Hong Long Properties, led by Romney Chen. Ryan's Xintiandi project in Shanghai and Hengsheng's Jianfu Palace renovation in Beijing. Beijing, that's the forbidden cities. In Beijing. That impressed me with the effort to preserve a cultural heritage. Inspired by Ryan, our project in Tianjin, Dongguan, Wuhan, and many cities have attempted to preserve local cultural heritage, which becomes a part of our symbol. Benchmark number four, Porter Homes, the biggest home builder in the United States. We learned from Porter Homes how to scale up operations in a huge market. They gave us very useful tools, such as customer classification, land investment, and the seven-step customer service. Several years later, we surpassed them. I mean that quantity, not quality. Thank you. In 1990, Vanke entered a new area. I stepped down as the CEO, coming with the start of my mountaineering. I visited the seven summits of the earth and set my foot on Mount Everest for twice. In 2000, on one of my mountaineering trips, I met Mr. Zhong Kimin, a businessman from Hong Kong, also like a preferred climber. Three years later, 2003, I again met Zhong Jianmin, Mr. Zhong Jianmin, in the base camp of Mount Everest. On that year, also we are not a team, but on that year, we all climbed the summit of Mount Everest. And then, after that, we traveled to Arctic and Antarctic together. His huge stamina and courage made him my benchmark also. I think that the Hong Kongese spirit. In 2002, when I visit Kilimanjaro, I recalled one of Hemingway's novels in that I had read many years ago. At the beginning of this story, Hemingway wrote, "Kilimanjaro is a snow-capped mountain, 19,710 feet high, and it has said to be the highest mountain in Africa." 66 years after Hemingway left us those words, I could not longer see snow at the peak of Kilimanjaro. In 2005, when hiking at the South Pole, that the company with Zhong Jianmin, we found that it was not as cold as we had expected. I ran bare chest in the world of ice and snow. Believe it or not, 20 minutes. 2 years later, I went to the Lobro. The record showed that the temperature should have been no higher than 45 degrees at that time. But on the first day, it was 49 degrees. And 52 degrees on the second day, I almost got killed. Either it's getting warmer, as an outdoor sports fan, I say yes. More data and the pictures are telling us yes, it is. In July 2008, I went to the Amazon to see the rainforest. However, I saw how the Amazon was suffering serious destruction. How are two aerial pictures of Brazil's Rondonia region taken 26 years apart? I was told that residential development not only changed the local environment, but also damaged the tropical rainforest. China is the world's biggest importer and consumer of tropical wood. 40% of wood products are exported to the US, Japan, and Europe, and the rest are consumed in China. In China's consumption, 70% goes to the construction sector. That lost a pitch. That meaning that the Vanke already are the biggest residential property developer in China. We consume a lot of wood that come from tropical forest. How we do? So that way to begin a revolution, how to reduce using the wood by constructing a residential building, so that the prefabrication. As we know, in Hong Kong, that some of the public house, in mainland China, that the protector housing, what can say that in Hong Kong, that the public house, that built by the prefabrication. But in mainland, that have no construction company use that method. That method that can a lot of reduce using the wood. So from 2007, Vanke began to use the prefabrication to build apartment. In 2011, Vanke built 2.7 million square meter residential home in industrialized way, meeting China's top green standard. It helped us serve 330 hectares of forest. By 2020, we will contribute to 0.12% of the yearly energy saving of China by building all houses in this way. I'm eager to say that we can make it 12% if the entire industry comes on board. At the stage we looked for, benchmark number 5, Japanese companies. For example, we learned from Japanese construction engineers to reduce the variance from centimeters to millimeters. We hope to catch up with the quality standards of Japanese colleagues within 5 to 10 years. Benchmark number 6. That's the BRE, Building Research Establishment. A few years ago, we learned from US Green Building Council in building our architecture research center as the zero carbon, zero waste facility. We are planning to build a green architecture park in Beijing, use BREEAM, the world's highest green standard of BRE. Today, one is very two green three-star homes, the top Chinese eco-building standard is built by Vanke. Learning does not always result in success. Sometimes people make jokes that in early 1990s, one time, I visited a high-end valley in Hainan province and found two toilets in one bathroom. I asked why. The developer told me that the house had two bathrooms, two kitchens, two sinks, and two showers. They decided that toilets come in a pair because there is supposed to be a lover's villa. It incidentally occurred to me that, oh yes, the lovers will brush teeth and wash face together. But it would be far too embarrassing to sit on the toilet at the same time. It also occurred to me that the developer must have mistaken, be there when the visitor wearing horses. I think it is more important to understand not just the symptoms, but logical behind them. Not just the techniques, but values. A few years ago, my digital camera was broken. I took it to the Japanese service, but I learned that cost of repair was more than replacing it. So I said, okay, I'd like a new one. However, the maintenance, the staff of maintenance station told me, every product had its own life. If you repair it, the life would go on. If you buy a new one, there came another life. I was deeply touched by these words. I have visited Japan many times, and I found that the values of quality is deeply rooted to their culture. Pursuing beauty in details as revealed in shadow, ikebana, and architecture is the origin of Japanese people's faith in quality. To continue the learning, I came to Harvard as a visiting scholar. Life in Harvard is like living in a medieval monastery. Everything started all over again, including learning the language. I once had an interview with a CBS report, who asked how much wealth I really owned. That's 1988. My answer was that the wealth kept me, the fund of Wang Shi was almost none. This caught him in big surprise. Research on business ethics usually point to individuals' leadership and the choice of values. Most people heard about Adam Smith's The Wealth of Nations. But now, what I'm working on is his another book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. My study at Harvard focused on business ethics. I look beyond Sony, SHKP, and Shui-En, and learn from Max Weber and Adam Smith. People ask, mountaineering versus studying at Harvard, which is more difficult? Researching the top of Everest, reaching the top of Everest once is considered difficult by many. Why twice? My answer is yes, it is difficult, but not as difficult as you might think. I knew studying at Harvard would be difficult, but it has turned out even more difficult than I had imagined. We are better now, but face more challenges, such as product quality, environment, and moral problems. Change is unavoidable. We have to see things through a new global perspective. I'm searching for a new benchmark at Harvard. Maybe I can't find them. No worries. I will pass along the task to Vanke's young team. Thanks.
I would suggest that for those non-Chinese speaking audience should put on their headset because I'm going to conduct my discussion with Wang Shi in Mandarin. I think that would, you know, hopefully we can get more subjects covered. Wang Shi, 我觉得你真的很了不起，你为什么能够在万科发展的那么快的时候， 积极流勇退的，去登山，现在又去哈佛去念书， 到底你自己是在怎么样 去想这个事情？
我刚才吹捧你了，你现在吹捧我是吧？这是互相吹捧是吧？我想在中国改革开放三十周年的时候呢，我也作为一个是过来的人嘛，当记者就问我说你对三十年有什么感想，和对未来又有什么感想呢？我用六个字来概括，就头三个字呢概括过去的三十年，对未来三十年呢也用三个字来概括。过去的三十年我用了就是说想不到，就是你刚才就来回答你这个问题了，就说你怎么做成这样？我说我也不知道，啊，因为这个市场变化的太快，自己懵懵懂懂，怎么现在成了名人了？因为我第一次讲演的时候一身汗，所以现在刚才看到我们那个颐和的大班那种自如的这样来在台上说，那我很羡慕是吧？实际上我现在也是蛮紧张。那对未来再发展三十年呢，我还用三个字来说，就是不确定。就在到底往哪儿走你不清楚，并不是说我一定会怎么样怎么样，所以来回答说怎么做那样呢，这是稀里糊涂的就直接到这里来了。
但是王石，你说不确定，但是我看万科现在这些发展的策略呢是很明确的，比如说你在2004年的时候已经说要每一年要增长30%，还有就是有一些你们叫5986的这个计划，或者5986，你跟我们大家介绍一下吧。这个我觉得也是很了不起，因为我自己是做同一个行业，我相信我自己做不到的。你介绍一下。
我们知道罗先生呢，他本身是学建筑的，本身他是搞他的专业的，搞建筑、搞房地产，他是一致的。像万科呢，实际上像中国很多新兴企业一样，机会非常非常多。做了很多很多业务，像我刚才介绍过了，万科做过很多业务，只不过最后直到你只有搞专业化，只有是这样的你才能在行业上站得住脚，所以才开始一个整顿过程。实际上让我最痛苦的是如何把你还在赚钱的企业把它关掉，把它卖掉。因为你知道它国内的这个产权交易不像在香港，很容易你说卖掉就卖掉了，但是你没卖掉的时候也可能两三年之后才能把它卖掉。你如果要卖掉，你要鼓励企业要好好干，但另一方面你要卖掉它，那是非常非常痛苦的，人格是非常分裂的，那个过程是非常痛苦。但是你已经确定了把它卖掉，专注做房地产，因为中国的市场非常好，所以应该说不是很难，不是很难。那这罗先生刚才提到了，我看他是做了功课是吧？对，实际上万科他有这么几个经历。我记得在万科发展10年的时候呢，我曾经做个畅想，我说什么时候万科能经营规模做到10亿人民币，利润1亿，我说那是一种什么场景啊？但是没想到这个通货膨胀涨得这么厉害是吧？这是没想到的。但是有几个是非常清楚的，就是说你专注做专业化，因为很多机会不要被这种机会呢所迷惑，专注做专业化就做下去。这点在中国大陆它是需要有一点抵制这种诱惑的。所以呢，这是如果说万科呢比较清楚来讲，就是说其他再有钱我们也不会去做。所以可以讲有这么一个故事，因为不断的有新的机会，我的团队就说我们现在做房地产是对的，那万一将来市场不好了，长期的市场中国的城市化完成了，我们还做房地产吗？我们难道就不做吗？你比如说像柯达这样的，他就是做这个胶片，他优秀的企业垮掉了，百年企业。我就说我在的时候你们就不要想做多元化，我说我不在了你怎么做和我没关系了。但是这句话我又改了，我说我不在，我就是死了，你们要做多元化，我也要从那个骨灰盒里伸出一只手来干扰你们。
但是刚才你说你好像很 什么都不管这样，其实我相信你是定了一个方向，一个方针之后，让他们整个管理团队去做出来，效率是很高。刚才我提的那个一串的数字5986，我是看过，他们万科买地之后5个月就要动工，9个月就要卖房子，一卖他就还有就是80%是要做这个住宅，
现在做不到了。
现在做不到，那你为什么不调整这个政策呢？
也在调，现在不是5986了，现在是可能是5946了。
那你一
卖就能卖出40%，相当不错了呀，现在市场。
当然今天是宏观调控，但是总的来说，这方面你自己是带领你的团队在调这些策略，是不是？你现在参与这个管理的工作到什么地步呢？只是总的方向还是怎么样？
我是1999年辞去总经理的职务之后呢，就不管了。我辞职的时候，我曾经有个辞职讲演的，在辞职讲演我说我给万科带来什么。我第一个，我说我们选择了一个行业，因为万科做了很多行业，选择了房地产。第二，说是建立了一个制度，叫现代企业制度。第三个，培养了个团队。第四，树立了个品牌。实际这就是我觉得管理企业呢，刚才说树立标杆的这么综合起来的这样一个把握。实际为什么说我可以长期的离开公司还能正常运转呢？实际一定是把它，我们这东方和西方很大的一个管理差异来讲呢，西方它是讲制度，东方是讲领导权威，讲领袖。所以我觉得做现代企业制度应该是学习西方的制度化。所以在万科来讲，你可以很重要，你可以不重要，你离开了，你在的时候很好，你离开的照样很好，可能是风格不同。所以对万科的管理方法呢，这就是我的一个理念。所以我相信这个万科呢，它会更持续的往下发展，就如何把东方的人治变成这样一个制度化的管理。再加上刚才说这个专业多元，你说多元化来讲，你绝对是离不开的，所以一定就是专注做这样的，这样的你在市场好的时候做得很好，市场不好的时候呢，就是你的优势才出来，才显现出来，是吧？就是专业、制度化、团队。所以管理，当然你说我管理什么东西，甚至我把握三个东西，把握三个东西，把握第一个东西，这个战略上，刚才说来讲，我说我们就从多元化到专业搞房地产，其他就不做了，这我要把握住的，这就叫做把握第一个专业的方向。第二个，你做的时候谁去做，这要把握的一个用人。第一个战略的做什么，第二个用人，第三个我觉得更重要的什么呢？只要一旦出问题，你即可承担责任。我们知道我们很多管理上的有这样的一个对话，你很信任的部下出了问题，他忐忑不安，你也感到很没面子，很生气的说，我这么信任你，辜负我的希望，对吧？你怎么把事情搞砸了？但我觉得对承担责任来讲，说无论从各方面来讲，只要是你用的团队个别人出了问题，你一定要承担责任。你承担两个责任，第一是吧，承认用人不善，不应该用他，你用他了，他出问题了，这不是你的责任吗？是吧？第二个，那你就是领导责任嘛，无论是什么责任，也可能是市场突然发生变化，你用谁都要出问题的，你要承担责任。所以对于我来讲，作为董事长，你作为方向确定了，制度建立了，团队有，你实际很重要的一个来讲什么呢？就是出了事你承担责任，因为好事都会往你身上推的，你推都推不掉，你不能好事是你的出了问题是你部下的。所以按我把握的一个很大的原则呢，就是承担责任。无论什么，你从哪个角度来讲，下面出事你承担责任。
但是王师，你说要承担责任，但是你现在那么潇洒的可以去美国念书，去一年，去登山，但是你怎么可以确保他们能够做你定下来这些标杆呢？我希望能够学习到你这样，那我不需要每天工作10多个小时啊。
刚才那个保洁那个前沿者来说了嘛，现在这个是如何，就是八零，我们大陆上叫八零后九零后，现在网络时代，你就登珠峰，你到峰顶上，你都可以电脑打开，哎，它就是互联网嘛，哎，所以说为什么还不能离开呢？恐怕和这个还得向八零后九零后学习，啥就是来用的是互联网。
就那你现在每天在哈佛，你还是会上网去看万科在做什么，跟你的同事有没有联系呢？第一一定有联系，第二呢，我就不好说我用多长时间，大概是用自己的精力差不多，最多十分之一的时间吧，最多十分之一时间进行这种联络。 那现在基本上，因为我是前十年都在登山，包括是董事会啊，基本来讲都是属于这种通过网上这样来召开，包括现在哈佛是三个月的一个季度的董事会呢，都是在网上来开的。当然有一次你不能通过网上的，就是股东大会，你一定要到现场的，哎，是这样。好。
现在我念念外面放进来这些问题吧，有观点认为国内的这个地产行业呢，大企业越来越强，小企业就越来越没得做了，强弱的这个分化日益明显，近年来的过境民退跟让中小房企啊不利是很艰难的，那么啊，适逢楼市的调控，作为大企业的万科要怎么应对？
中小房企，你又认为它可以怎么样来应对呢？这里有几个问题啊，一个就是说是大企业越大，小企业越来越难做。我想实际上呢，就是作为一个市场上的这样一个占有份额来讲呢，严格来讲，包括万科在内，对市场的这样一个影响力呢，还远远不够的。比如说在日本市，香港就不用说了，那太典型了，是吧？九大房地产企业。 或者六大基本占了80%的市场。那我们就来讲是比较大的，像美国和日本，前五大公司市场占有份额呢，是在百分之，美国是占到18%，前五大公司，美国呢是占的20%。那我们再看中国，平均下来差不多呢，前五大公司呢，这差不多市场占有份额的4%。 4%左右， 4%到5%平均，按理讲第一大的应该占到6%到8%，而实际上万科呢，我们也占的百分份额呢是 2%，2.2%几，就是企业还没有大到按照一个正常的市场的一个规模。中国这个房地产市场太大，所以还不存在一个说如果大公司越来越大，小公司越来越小的这样一个问题，不存在的。从比较来讲，很能说明这个问题，也就是说一个市场要成熟。 没有这样的几大领军的房地产公司呢，当然像香港这样的，它很特别，它占的份额非常非常大的，但至少来讲，前五大平均下来市场份额每一家占的 4% 是最起码的，但现在远没到。第二个我们再看是，讲了一个国进民退的问题，确实是国进民退，确实是现在资源占用的非常不平衡，那所以资源角度来讲，就是说。 简单的数字来讲，就是说，显出来讲呢，国有非常赚钱，尤其银行赚钱赚的一塌糊涂。我觉得那是个垄断的结果，并不是一个效率的结果。所以现在这种趋势的国进民退，如果再继续下去，我觉得经济上从长远来讲会有出问题的。这是我第二个看法，就这种国进民退是不利于这样市场的一个资源分配的。第三个。 就是现在，这市场调控的时候，小企业感到很难做，中小企业怎么办？那我开出的处方啊，因为我也是中小企业过来的，我开的处方来讲，第一，难做就别做了嘛。对，你要是敢难做的话，就别做了，因为我想说的什么意思呢？我们很多中小企业基本都不是专一做房地产的，哎，他又做这个做那个。 如果不是专一的，我劝你退出去。这是我开的第一个处方，是吧？你退出去，就是房地产的黄金的 只要买了地就赚钱，只要卖房子就赚钱，那个时代已经过去了。这是我第一个建议。第二个建议就是，哎，那我是多元化，但是我想其他的我想推掉。你房地产不容易，其他也不容易，相对来讲房地产容易一点啊。我说如果你这个判断我同意的，相对房地产相当其他行业当中，家电啊其他行业那种竞争还没有那么激烈，哎，但是你要把其他的放掉，专注做房地产，这第二个处方。第三个处方怎么办？怎么办？拖呗，是吧？我在哈佛那儿很多研究中国的房地产的这个市场分析来讲，说今年中国的房地产要破产，要破产。为什么？第一，因为这个土地市场基本上靠地方政府土地财政，现在土地卖不出去了，地方政府可能要破产，是吧？要拖垮银行。第二个，很多房地产项目借的钱啊还不了啊，那个都破产潮，那就是今年是中国的破产年。我心里想，怎么可能？怎么可能？那当然，西方是2008年的金融危机、金融海啸。我说，你能把中国的金融市场看得这么有效率吗？是不是啊？你把它看这么有效率吗？就是它完全按照西方的这个效率这样的一个原则来判断中国，当然结论是非常非常悲观的。当然，你说中国现在有没有问题？有非常大的问题，但它绝不会是以这两三年之内以破产的形式出现。他会拖，哎，为什么呢？我说这个拖呢，不是我让他拖，银行让你拖，你想破产，银行都不让你破产，是吧？你说还不了钱，你先别还嘛。你说我利息都还不了，利息咱们也还好说。你说是不是啊？哎，所以说是这个，但是我们再看看，中国现在中央政府这样的严厉的房地产控制，严厉的中央政策控制房地产，我个人认为我是举双手赞成的。举双手赞同，因为我们知道中国呢，虽然有很大的问题，但是它还在发展当中。这个速度，只要你不降到7%以下啊，我不是经济学家啊，这个速度只要不要降到以下，一直持续下去，它可以一些问题，包括刚才说的那些问题，借贷问题呢，都在发展当中的逐步缓解，把这房地产价格抑制住了。在这过程当中，可能它不会破裂，可能会软着陆。如果不控制这个房价，继续让它涨上去，那中国会非常非常糟糕的。所以尽管现在房地产控制来讲让我们企业很痛苦很难受，我就告诉你，那比日本房地产破灭之后要好得多。但是我们真的破了，我们是没有日本的那种承受能力的，那就非常非常糟糕的。所以我衷心希望中央的房地产政策继续调下去，哎，你调了半途而废，这个可能就很糟糕了。哎，所以怎么办？不要抱幻想说哎怎么办？但是今年会有些微调，因为你已经非常明确，他压房地产，他并不是为了要压正常的消费，而要压这种房价上涨。所以今年我想，在抑制房地产前提下，政策会微调，会鼓励正常的消费。所以开出最后一个处方，就是你要无论是你专做房地产还是多元化的，最后我都要做房地产的，那我告诉你，沉住气，要调整你的产品，调整如何来讲你的专注，像恒隆这样的，像瑞安这样的专注，而且做出你的特色，小有小的做法，大有大的做法。房地产和其他行业不一样，任何行业来讲都会挤大家之后呢，没有小的生存空间。房地产恰好它的特殊性，刚才讲了，就是美国日本最大的房地产公司前五家占的市场份额也就是20%不超过的，所以应该说空间不存在小的就做不下去的，这个不用担心的，这是我想说的。
因为时间的问题，我问一个问题，就是有关你自己在万科的这个角色。我看到呢，你们是有一个目标，2014年要做到2000亿的这个销售，那你会这样的下去的发展，去年你是做1200亿，要是2014年要做2000亿，这个增长还是很厉害的。那需不需要你自己要参与多一点来带领这个做到这个目标呢？
那我参与呢，那就会只能少不会多。因为实际上，万科曾经是在这是几年前，两千 14年呢是万科20周年，我们曾经对未来的做了预测当中，应该说增长还是万科当时的一个很主要的目标。应该说现在已经非常明确进行了调整，不是因为国家进行调整我们进行调整，和国家调整没有关系的。就如何从追求数量，到如何把质量，把尊重环保，把一个更多的强调是客户和股东的关系更多强调的对环境、对社会、对员工，这样就所谓的 stakeholders， 就是各种相关利益的集团的平衡的去考虑往前推进，所以这个数量将来是怎么样，它是个结果，不是个目标。但确实呢，从万科增长当中呢，它有周期性。我们过去的呢，从来算万科过去的增长线呢，基本加权平均呢是平均增长是35%，这个很有意思。它是平均是这个概念，但从增长不同期来讲，你会发现，在增长， 有的时候增长会80%、100%的增长，往往两年这种高速增长之后呢，就会一个只有10%、15%的这个增长之后又上去，所以这个就给我们得出一个结论：市场是非常公平的，你的增长超高速增长，它一定会进行调整，放缓过来，它像已经是周期的。所以对于数量方面呢，实际上现在呢，万科也还在进行检讨。 比如说现在一些同行也在说要追万科，这一追万科呢，万科就很紧张，因为什么呢？你要保持老大的地位啊，你要追我不让你追啊，所以就你要更快的增长，我觉得这个是有问题的，所以我说你要你就是被它超过去有什么不好呢？啊，因为万科的数量规模已经很大了，如果只要超过去，万科遇到问题，它一定会遇到我。 所以一定是不能说是为了保持第一不顾质量的增长，不顾质量的增长数量，所以万科来进行把握的来讲，就是2020年是到底是它是多少，是不是很重要，但是按着就是说平均万中国的这样的一个市场，和只要你把握了方向。 那如果是即使通货膨胀压制的比较得当，这个2000亿在中国的市场也不是个大数字，是吧？好，因为时间的问题呢，那问你最后一个问题了，这里面，你成为一个非常有名的企业家，名誉给你带来什么？给你带走什么？当然。
当然能做到这里来当个有名的人，当我是虚荣心是得到极大的满足，是吧？当然还有另外一场合，为什么作为一个企业家能邀请到哈佛去学习呢？这都是过际梦想都不敢想的。当然给带来自己觉得是很成功的，但成功也好不成功也好，是一个人的一生呢。我觉得就是一个抛物线，所以抛物线呢，它一定是从低向高走，到一定程度它一定在下去的。 这是一层含义，就是不管你愿意不愿意，它一定下去的。第二个含义来讲，抛物线呢，叫人生过程当中呢有奋斗，奋斗你会做出很多牺牲的。那你什么时候享受呢？如果你认为你就是这个高峰，一直往上走，你就来不及享受，我觉得人生是遗憾的。但什么时候享受实际上抛物线呢往下走的时候，这个是应该是你享受的时候。实际作为我来讲呢，我的人生的抛物线最高峰已经过去了。 那到哈佛学习本身就包括一个自己的修为啊，自己愿意做自己愿意的事情上。那我觉得对我的定位来讲呢，就是现在不是应该说怎么再去出名，而是那抛物线最后到归零的时候，那是无声无息。不要你的离开这个世界的成为一个新闻，这就是我对我这一生的定位吧。
好吧，时间已经到了，请大家跟我一起鼓掌，这个非常特别的一个人。